talked about the ABCs of bourbon and what makes bourbon bourbon. Who's got the A for me?
Oh. American made.
American made. Nice. Who's got the B?
Barrel aged.
Who's got the C?
Charred.
Not charred. That'd be the barrel.
Yeah.
51%?
Corn.
Who's got the D? I'll give you the D, distillation proof. What's the percentage that it has to become off the still or less?
80
off the still.
160.
Yeah!
I know you wanted to say 5 after that, but we're happy to know.
E will be entry proof, the proof that it has to go in into the barrel or less.
That's 80. Wait, how much proof goes inside the bottle?
125 or less. 125 or less going into the barrel.
There we go. Rachel added again.
And then the fill proof, the proof that it can go in or above going into the bottle. Rachel had a hand up. 80.
There you go.
NG.
Genuine.
Hey, I'm good with it. If you know it, show it, right? And genuine products of the United States. No worries there. My slides are out of order. So I'm going to pass it over to Scott, who's going to talk about Brown-Forman and Woodford Reserve today.
What's going on, guys?
Hey, how you doing?
Awesome. My name is Scott Clifford. I represent Brown-Forman here in Palm Beach County and going a little bit north. Just a little bit about me. I come from the bartending side of this world. I just switched to brand work very recently. So I've sat in on tons of these, just like you guys are now. And I'm just really happy you guys gave me the time to talk to you about Woodford Reserve a little bit. It's amazing you guys are doing these classes to have that kind of the base level of knowledge. What week of classes is this?
Three
already? Mm-hmm. Awesome. That's really cool. So, because usually I like to start with a little 101, but you guys definitely have that covered, so we're just going to dive into the brand a little bit. So, who's familiar with just Brown-Forman as a company in general? The experts over here to the right.
And the one wearing one for sure.
I've heard.
Yeah, can you name some of our brands?
Maybe.
There's no wrong answer.
No.
Woodford. Boom. But under our umbrella, with Jack Daniels, Old Forester,
yeah.
Cooper's Craft, Woodford Reserve, Herradura, and Tequila now, a few other things that are in our under us. But we're here to talk about Woodford. Woodford has actually only been in the market for a little over 20 years. It was released for the first time in 1996. But where we make Woodford and everything about Woodford goes back a lot further in time. All right, so there's 5 important things to know about Woodford. That's the 5 factors of flavor that we talk about. All right, so first would be grain. All right, so we are 72% corn, 18% rye, and 10% malted barley mash bill. And that malted barley plays a really important part because how those enzymes break down the corn and the rye.
Could you go with that percentage one more time?
Yeah, yeah. So corn is 72%,
okay.
Rye is 18%, and it's 10% malted barley.
Thank you.
And so across all Woodford SKUs, they have the same exact mash bill. All right, it's just how we finish it, except of course with the rye, kind of flip that percentage a little bit. But when it comes to the double oak, single malt, all that sort of stuff. Second one is the water. So our water is coming straight off the property out of Pepper Springs. So they built a well. So this is super mineral rich water that doesn't have to be treated, filtered, or anything. And that's why it contributes to such a clean, base of flavor for the Woodford. And now we're just gonna, the next 2 steps, kind of fermentation and distillation. we're going to take kind of like a trip back in time a little bit. So where Woodford Reserve is made, this is where the second generation of the Pepper family and James Crow, you might have heard the term Old Crow before. This is where basically those two gentlemen came up with all the modernized ways that we make bourbon today. The barrel aging, the char, all of these sorts of things. So when Brown-Forman took over this property again, they had a decision. You know, we could build a super state-of-the-art distillery, you know, but they decided that they wanted to bring things back to how they would have been making it in the 1800s. So instead of steel fermentation tanks, we have red cypress. So with the red cypress, it's a couple things. So Woodford, we do smaller batch. We do smaller batches. We don't do massive amounts. So the red cypress, the size of that and the openness of it allows the yeast to really kind of do its thing. We have a proprietary yeast. And so as it's fermenting, it ferments for 6 days compared to the typical three. And so the combination of that extra time and the red cypress, it brings out a ton more floral citrus notes than you're typically going to find. And then once it leaves those fermentation tanks, the distillation process is pretty unique for American bourbon. So it's going to go through three copper pot stills. In copper pot stills, you're going to traditionally find more with like Irish whiskey making. Does anyone know like much of a difference between pot stills and column stills?
No.
I know.
So pot stills, you're going to use more traditionally with smaller batch items because it's basically just pulling the mash apart, and it's going to come out less filtered and capture a lot more of the flavor. When you're doing more mass-produced stuff, you're going to want to have a column still because you can continuously distill. You can also come out at like a much higher ABV for, more neutral spirits like vodka and that sort of stuff. All right, so you're capturing a lot more of the natural flavor using the three pot stills than you would with the more more modern tradition of a column still. And then lastly, our maturation process. Woodford is matured for plus or minus 7 years. The barrel typically has a char level of 3. We're not adding a ton of smoke or any of that charcoal toasted sort of flavor, but it's definitely present.
What is this when you say 3 out of what? What's the scale out of 10?
Char level goes to 6.
It's not proprietary. Each cooperage is going to have different levels.
Oh, okay.
Most
so there's not a standard.
Okay. Yeah, most of them do a 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 being a 55-second burn, and I've got a video that we'll come to later from Brown-Forman last week. There was some reading that I did said that they go up to like a 7 or an 8, but again, each cooperage is going to be different in how.
So somebody's 7 could be their 3 and just whatever. Okay.
It depends on the cooperage, and each bourbon company and each different master distiller is going to ask for a different kind of char.
But you said kind of like expect like a level 1 to be what, 15 seconds, and a 4 to be like 55 seconds?
For the most part, yeah.
Is that?
Yeah, I mean, like she said, I mean, it's just kind of a general guideline. And then, I mean, the higher the number, the more of that kind of burnt, super toasted flavor that's going to add on to the bourbon. So Woodford Reserve is also unique in a way where it's going into the barrel at 110 proof. So you guys just went over, it's typically a little bit lower than 125. So Woodford Reserve does this for the purpose of being able to fill the barrel as much as humanly possible. That way they're exposing the juice to as much wood, so they're gaining all that flavor. And if you picture it literally within the first day, that barrel's already absorbed 3 to 4 gallons of whiskey into it, creating that headspace. And by the end of the 7 years, you're looking at around a 40% angel share. We're all familiar with the angel share, I'm assuming?
No. When the eagles, right? When it evaporates?
Right, so what they call, so anything that evaporates out of the barrel is called the angel share, going to the heavens. So, I mean, it's being able to add all those extra flavors from the barrels really adds, to the complexity and flavor profile of Woodford Reserve bourbon. So you guys want to take a little sniff, see what we have?
So one of the things that I picked up that changed tasting and changed my perception of different bourbons was in class, they said your first sip was always going to be a shock to your palate. Mm-hmm. At that point, you should let that bourbon hang out and almost rinse it like mouthwash for 8 to 10 seconds. And it goes until your eyes water. And it's not fun, but it changes dramatically on your second sip. It just opens all of your taste buds up to it. So give that a try and see how much it changes what you taste and what you get. That big swirl, Kentucky Chew, just move it around your mouth.
Yeah, your tongue's not always ready for it. So what are you guys getting out of the nose?
Get
almond.
Almond.
Vanilla.
Vanilla, definitely. Very typical.
Some citrus on the back, like an oily citrus.
Yeah. Citrus should be definitely present. Does everyone taste it?
Use your mouth, not your nose.
Not snort the wood.
Chomp a line of burgers.
All right, so what's everyone tasting?
Caramel.
Very nice. It's
definitely caramel.
Baking
spices. Baking spices?
Yes.
So what sort of flavors would pair well with kind of what you guys are tasting?
Caramel apple.
Or what kind of cocktails for the bartender, What comes to mind?
Old fashioned, for sure. I mean, is that what you're asking?
Chocolate old fashioned.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Definitely get some chocolate, right?
Chocolate.
Cola, maybe.
Like, be delicious. Yeah,
would you drink this on the meat with a splash of water, or do you need to open it up, or?
You definitely
could. I'll get you some water.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, I don't know if it's proper or not. I just heard that you want to add a little bit of water.
Oh yeah, if you're drinking bourbon neat, or any brown spirit, after you take a couple sips, kind of get the natural flavor profile, adding water will kind of open up some flavors that aren't there.
I had a guest actually asking for a straw. With a glass of water.
So you could just drop it in?
Yeah. It's usually best not to give them, just, I usually like to put rocks on the side, because some people are very particular about having too much water.
Right.
And the ice dissipate and melt in there, that it changes the taste of it.
So going back to the water for Woodford, what's the one ingredient that's in every cocktail?
Water.
Exactly. So going back to that dilution level, I mean, it's very important. As a bartender, you're paying attention to how much ice you're putting in your shaker. If it's a shaking cocktail, how long you're shaking it for, how long you're stirring it for, because, for spirit-forward cocktails, let's say, you don't stir it enough. It's going to come out a little hot, too much flavor almost, for your customer. Or if you stir it for too long, it's going to come out watery. Especially if you think about a drink that's going out to service, if you already over-dilute it, and then it's sitting there on a rock, hypothetically. Takes a couple minutes for the server to get there. By the time it gets to the table, I mean, your drink's way more closer to dead than it ever should be. So these things you just gotta keep in mind as, when you're using specific bourbons or flavor profiles, is what that dilution level should be. Another really great cocktail for the base Woodford is the mint julep. The kind of chocolate coconut notes in the Woodford play really well with the mint. And if you're doing like a properly made mint julep, you're adding about a quarter ounce to half an ounce, simple at most, if you're using simple. And then just that mint, sugar, and then still getting that spirit forward flavor from the bourbon.
So when you asked about the tasting, somebody said chocolate, right? It would pair well with chocolate?
Yep.
Who said that?
Yeah.
Sorry, keep going.
Yeah, sorry. I started rambling instead of giving you guys what you want. So what do you guys think so far?
Big difference.
Oh yeah, like you said, you're just warming up your palate.
If you like open all of those taste buds and say, hey, here's your shock, and then go back for a second one. Mm-hmm. The other one was really cool that when they do tasting panels, they taste first as it's full proof straight out of the bottle, and then they add a good amount of water. You're gonna get so much more characteristic out of the bourbon with water added. What do they say, 40%?
Well, I keep writing down things where like I had that like aha moment, and like he's already touched on five of them. But like when we, because you know we're gonna do a deep science dive. But when they actually talked about where you can get the proper expression from everything, it was the sequence of adding water. So at different proofs, you're going to get different notes of that, but the stronger that's gonna go, we're gonna start dropping conjugate terms. But like the alcohol forward ones, or alcohol soluble, if you will, anything that's gonna be created from that versus the ones that are created from water, you kind of worked your way down. So we actually had to go with like blind tastings for this and be able to pull out and extrapolate all those different flavors. We might have started at 117 proof, but it's like drop the water, go back, and it worked its way down to get the proper, like when you flavor man, when we got in there, as far as like what they were actually pulling out of different things, to get the proper expression to pull everything out was at 40 proof, that low. So really when you, like there are some things that you can only get at the higher proof, there are certain aromas that are only gonna carry with that. Same thing. Talking about age versus proof versus all the interactions with the angel share and all that. But to just see that evolution of like, I just got 20 things out of this, but I got 7 added water, I got 3 more added, like that to me was really cool.
It comes in layers.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, that comedy, I mean, that's one of the coolest parts, you know. Bourbon, you know, at its root, you know, you think it's very simple. You just think, you know, wood, vanilla, caramel, you know. But the complexities that exist, you know, within that and how they play with either that dilution level, like you said, or any other flavors that you might be adding into a cocktail, really is what brings those flavors out. And that's what you guys got to think about. It's like, how can I bring this note out when you're, you know, coming up with the drink?
I was thinking that, like, usually you would probably customize like an old fashioned with wood for dessert, and you would smoke some cinnamon, kind of angle it and cover it in the glass, and then build it with like vanilla, orange bitters, like chill it, accentuate that.
Yeah, bring out those baking spices, bring out more of that vanilla flavor. I mean, that sounds delicious. It's
yeah,
having
you're on this to be like, because we have like a smoking system where we can like smoke our, say, an old fashioned or like a Manhattan. Like, would you recommend that for this, or does it already have like?
I mean, Woodford's not naturally very smoky, so I mean, mm-hmm. that's going to be more on a case by case basis.
Yeah.
I think Woodford would pick up those flavors very nicely and play with the smoke. You know, so for your customers that do enjoy, you know, more of that smoky flavor, because it's bold enough in its natural flavors that it's not going to get super overshadowed by the smoke. You know, because some people just want to get, you know, killed by that, and weaker bourbons will get wiped, you know, the flavor profiles will get wiped out by that. But I think Woodford stands up on its own with its bold flavors, which you, again, that goes back to the distilling process and using the copper pot stills instead of the common stills, using those smaller batches, keeping, you know, not filtering as much, keeping a lot of that flavor, natural flavors, just in the juice.
Lauren, I love the idea and I love the thought. Right now, since the smoking is really only offered upstairs, it's not something that we're doing downstairs at this point, just for a sales perspective, but I love the thought.
Some people ask too, because they're like so used
absolutely.
To it.
Well, because they've had it.
They've had it,
had it up here, and we'll take it downstairs, but they don't do the whole presentation downstairs.
Okay.
You know, one thing going forward, we'll get it in here, is the Woodford Double Oaked. And then, you know, for that customer who's looking for more of that flavor profile, and hopefully they'll have me back another time. I can bring in a couple more of our expressions. You taste that in just a simple fashion with that. It'll blow that person's mind.
Question. You said this is a 7-year?
Yeah.
Do you have anything greater than 7 years?
No. So Woodford doesn't carry an age statement. So it's just our expressions are, quantified by how we're finishing them.
Something to touch on that. Could you explain in the barrel house? You guys, I believe this is right, but wrong.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. So explain why 7 years actually seems like it's more.
Right. This is a great point. I wanted to talk about this too. Thank you for reminding me. So our barrel house is really cool. So We keep it heated throughout the winter. You know, obviously Kentucky very warm in the summers. But so what that does throughout the winter is it allows the barrels to keep breathing the entire time. So that juice is coming in and out, getting exposed to that wood continuously over the course of the year, instead of becoming a little bit more stagnant if it was just in the heated room. And one of the cooler parts about Woodford Reserve is, you know, you would think that's a really wasteful process, just heating the rick house throughout the entire year. But what we're doing is we're taking the steam from the distillery and we're pumping that into the rick house. So it's a super sustainable process. So from our own water source that's on the property to recycling heat sources, Woodford Reserve is by far one of the more sustainable distilleries that exist.
What makes it reserve?
We just like to say
marketing.
It's very special to us. Yeah, I mean, it's just our the mainline, the bourbon distiller select, our master distiller, Chris Morris. He was making bourbon for 40 years. And our master taster, Elizabeth McCall, who's a super duper impressive lady. I mean, we're the same age, and she's next in line to be a master distiller at Woodford Reserve, which is insanely, like, what an accomplishment, especially for a woman in this business to rise up the ranks in a company like that. She's just a really crazy talented person. So the combination of the two of them doing, you know, constantly sampling barrels and making sure that it's coming out, you know, the way we want it to every time. So that's why I can speak more to the distiller select than Woodford Reserve. Just sounds very official. All right, so what are the five factors of flavor?
Fermentation. Recovered by distillation, and then 7 years on the maturation.
We hit all the points. That sounds great.
Yeast fermentation, distillation.
Wait, you didn't answer that one. Oh, you got one?
Yeah. Sorry, I got booked for this a little late, so next time I come, I'll bring you more brand-specific swag. But I got you what I could in a day.
Swag bag.
Yeah.
We've got a prize basket that's growing weekly, so we'll have
sweet. Well, I'll make sure to throw something in that for you guys then, too.
Can you talk about the cooperage?
Cooperage. So Brown-Forman is very unique. Because we have one of the world's foremost cooperages. Anyone know what a cooper is or a cooperage?
No.
We've talked about it, guys.
It's where they prepare the barrels.
Yeah.
It's where they make the barrels.
Okay.
Awesome.
Hey,
so,
sure for you.
All right.
Just say anything, we'll give you something. And you'd be amazed at what a big export and just a huge part of the business is for Brown-Forman is exporting our barrels. Either our used barrels or new barrels, and it's very unique for a distillery to have something like this, especially at the scale that it's at. I mean, I think she can speak to me. You're just there, right?
It's mind-blowing how big it is, but it is driving in. I'm like, am I going to the right place? Because you're driving back behind the airport in access roads, and then there's a cooperage there, and you go in and you check in, and she was amazing. Meredith at Brown-Forman and with the cooperage did a fantastic tour. It is not Disney World. It is not a curated tour. It is, you walk along a forklift path, but seeing that process from beginning to end, what did they do in the 30 minutes we were there? 60 barrels? And they were 91 barrels in the hour that we were in the cooperage. The guys fixing them by hand or using original tools.
Yeah, if you've ever seen a video of this, I mean, this is hard.
Wait, I'm sorry, what are you asking for?
This is amazing.
So this is sped up. So they will, and from what they were saying then, this part cannot be mechanized. This part has to be done by hand. Each of those staves, 50?
29 to 33, always on that number.
Staves that go in are always put in by hand. This is a sped up video, so it's not crazy long to watch. She said that he was one of the slower guys in the crew. I'm like, I'm sorry, what?
He's probably only worked there for 15 years. Compared to the...
Well, the guy retired at 50. He literally worked 50 years in the same station. Retired a few months ago.
Yeah, we can do it again.
So just picture that. Hand placing all of those.
But we watched him put two or three barrels together, and he puts them all around the edge, all around... And then he gets to the last one, and he picks one up, and this one's not good, and then this one's not good, and then the third one's right. But during that process, and it's hard to see because it's a sped-up video, he threw away more staves, staves that weren't good enough or cracked or along the process. Because once they go from here, they get the bands around each of the layers, and then they go, and they get fired.
It's the Charlo's that we were talking about.
Yeah, so we couldn't see the toasting part. Toasting part is just basically when they heat it up, because that's what's actually going to go into, like, that's where you're going to get your flavor, is how deep the toast is. That's proprietary, so that was hidden, and they don't show anybody. But the charring is the part where they actually go blast char it. So the char doesn't actually add the flavor to it. It becomes a filtration aspect, but it changes, exactly, I did the same thing, changes the wood on a more molecular structure, which allows the bourbon to interact with that toast level below the char.
And is toasting kind of just like putting them in a big oven?
Yep, slow long heat.
Okay.
It's a little slower in comparison to this.
So after they were rolled off of here, then they brought them like right over, and you could just smell what freshly charred barrel smells like. That's a smell I'm never going to forget, and that's a smell that will take me to this hot warehouse standing by the fire in August. But they're tested, they're blast tested for pressure. If they don't pass the tests, they go to hand coopers that are fixing each of the barrels individually. It's a really, really cool process. If you have the opportunity to visit a cooperage, this was phenomenal. This might be my favorite.
That was my thing in Napa too. Was the cooperage.
Do you know the price per barrel that they purchase it?
So I asked when I was there, and because Brown-Forman keeps all of their barrels within the company, they don't have a price.
Oh. Okay.
Used barrels usually sell for about $180 once they've been used once, because you can only use it once.
Right.
It's hard to say what a new barrel costs.
They're expensive, right?
Well, yeah, for some reason the bourbon one seemed cheaper than the wine ones.
The wine ones, yeah.
Wine, I always got the number in California.
It's like what?
$1,200. And here for new ones, if you were buying them from the cooperage that sells them to people that you could buy a one off, obviously when you're buying in bulk, it would be cheap. They always told me
to go
from them to Poppy. But yeah, if you were going to buy them individually, it could be like from $400 to $600.
Okay.
Somebody did make one with the Japanese oak, paid $5,500 for one barrel, just to give it a shot.
So, interesting question, and Josh asked the other day, and Josh did a competition today, but I've let him know individually, barrels do not have to be American oak. They also don't have to be white oak. They just have to be oak. They're white because of the pores in the oak that once they're fired, they seal and make a watertight seal, not airtight. That's where the expansion comes in, but they become watertight. You can use red oak, but it's more porous and it leaks out like
an empty barrel in 6 months or something.
Something like that. You can also use, and this was my question at Buffalo Trace, was that
it doesn't have to be white oak.
It doesn't
it
have to
doesn't,
be white,
it
and it doesn't
be.
Have to be American. Most of the time, it is. And that's because of the cost that goes behind it. Because there was one, the Mongolian
oak. Well, they made a Mongolian oak that they did for a one-off project at Buffalo Trace. But, like, you know, the Slovenian oak that they were using for some of those. My thought was just ship, the empty barrel weighs 107 pounds. When you weigh it at the end, that's how you calculate, there's about 3 gallons of liquid in there. Ship anything that weighs 107 pounds and let me know what your cost is.
Cool thing that I pick up. What does a full barrel of bourbon weigh?
150 pounds.
Close, a little high, about 500 pounds. From the cooperage to fill, to full, how much time passes? from coming off the still and being coming off the cooperage, being put on a truck, being shipped to most of your Brown Foreman barrels go to Jack Daniels. Thought about stopping by Jack Daniels 2 days later and seeing the barrels that were most likely just made being filled. How quickly or how slowly does a barrel go from cooperage to full of bourbon or whiskey?
3 days.
I would say 1 week.
2 days. 48 hours.
Most I imagine time. Since they're fairly close, your transportation would be very long. So.
Good thought.
Yeah, I mean, and I'll just leave you guys with this. I mean, this is a great example of just how unique Brown Foreman is as a company, because you think Jack Daniels, you just think this big, massive conglomerate thing. A lot of, I mean, look, I came up during the craft movement, you know, plenty of, me including, thought the same way, like, Jack isn't a craft whiskey, blah, 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 blah. But it's just not true. I mean, you see this, we handmake our own barrels. This goes for all our products. Handmake our own barrels. We're hand touching this. It's like human made stuff, and it's still a family owned company, going on, you know, 100-something years now. So it's just really impressive that they put this much time and care into their products and are able to, you know, make, you know, American made products like this that make such a difference in the flavor and the product. So it's just really cool.
On your journeys around, Brown Foreman produces 600,000 barrels a year. Each of the bands at each of the elements, the bands, the rivets all have bees in them. So
all have what bees? The
bees,
letter B?
B like Brown Foreman.
If it's made at that one in Louisville, if it's made at 80% of the barrels from this one, which is mind blowing how much they make, go to Jack, and then they have a secondary facility in Decatur, Alabama, I believe. And 100% of those go to Jack. So if they're made in Decatur, they've got the J. And up here, they've got the B.
Is it from Louisville or Dry County?
No.
So, I can attest.
Lynchburg.
No.
Lynchburg, Tennessee is
Lynchburg
technically a dry town. Which is strange.
I know it was a
town
in
there. Right?
Definitely not.
So,
six or seven reasons.
Yeah.
But that gets into the concept of what is dry, because you can still consume it, you just can't sell it or anything. So, like, they could give you, like, you could buy the bottle. Like, hey, congrats, you got an empty bottle. And then you could go fill something. So, like, they were trucking people 17 miles to a tasting room a while ago, but I think they worked their way around the law. Same thing, like, in Prohibition. If you had stacks of stuff and you wanted to open a speakeasy, sure, can't sell it, can't do anything, but you can still consume it. It's weird, like, with the...
Yeah, like, during Prohibition, like, one of our brands, Old Forester, that's why it's been, like, the longest-running distillery in America, because during Prohibition, you could get Old Forester with... doctor's prescription. They got a special license, so where it was medicine now for those handful of years, which is just hilarious to think about.
Yeah, and every ailment
gets
another prescription.
Whiskey, please.
For 10 days. It's like, oh, your elbow hurts? What about your knee? Every one of those was the prescription.
It doesn't have anything to do with medicinal as far as the origination of that, does it?
No, I mean, Old Forester existed. Yeah. The Browns just... If you go through the history of the company, they had a lot of foresight. Because even they predicted World War II was going to break out and started doing industrial strength alcohol for the military. These guys have just been on top of it at every turn. It's really, really impressive. It's something worth checking out. Because like I said, they're still family owned. It's still an American company. You think at some of the other brands that bartenders love to use. They probably just built their first distillery in the last handful of years after being a label for the last 10, you know. So Brown Foreman is just like, it's a really impressive company.
Awesome. Scott, thank you
so
much.
No, thank you guys.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate it.
You should be here. She was supposed to be here at 1:30. Okay.
So let's try it
again.
You
want to
start?
You want to do stuff or what?
We
can
start pouring some things.
Yeah.
Same
one.
Do you
want to
start with the double
rye
before, like,
end
the
baby
tie?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So you said, like, it has to be genuine. You can't add anything to
So the only thing that's going into bourbon, water, cereal grains.
That's
the flavor comes from the yeast, the barley, the grains, the cereal grains that they choose to use, the water in the barrels. As soon as you put it into something else, example will be two bourbons down the road, that's not bourbon anymore. It's whiskey. Yeah, that's in the sense that bourbon is whiskey. Whiskey is not bourbon.
So is Jack Daniel's whiskey?
Jack Daniel's is whiskey.
So
the only
additional flavor.
The only difference between Tennessee whiskey and bourbon is Tennessee Pride and charcoal filtration. Maple charcoal filtration.
But remember, it's filtration, so it's subtracted, not added.
Just like everybody probably has charcoal filters at their home. They're Brita filters. Those are charcoal filters. You're taking things out of the water through a charcoal filter, and that's when it was like, oh, that makes sense. High West, really cool stuff coming out of Park City, Utah. This was founded in 2006 by David Perkins and his wife, Jane. They visited Maker's Mark in Loretta, Kentucky, and as a biochemist, he's like, there are a lot of parallels between what I do in biochemistry and whiskey, and I like the Old West, and I like whiskey, so I want to go out and I want to make my own products. They founded the distillery in 2006 after living in Utah for 2 years. At that point, they began distilling in 2007. In 2016, 9 years later, High West was voted Whiskey's Advocate Distillery of the Year. So in a very short time, they changed. They became very quickly popular in the industry. What I think is so cool about High West is no distillery operated in Utah after 1870. That was when the last distillery in Utah closed. Aside from that, in 1933, Utah cast the 36th vote that ended Prohibition. And the thing they said then is, no other state shall take this glory away from Utah. So from 1870 to 2006, there were no active distilleries in the state of Utah. No new distilleries in the state of Utah. And this is the one that changed that. So High West distilled in Park City. There are three locations. They're distilling in, I forget the name of the city. There's a distillery, there's the saloon in Park City, and then there is the shop at the airport at the Salt Lake City airport. What you have in the glasses, what did we pour first? Double rye?
Double rye.
Double rye. I'm going to pass this to
Vinny.
Nisha, can I pass this one to you?
Vinny.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'll take a bottle.
Hello.
Vinny. So the double rye, actually the reason we're starting with this is because this is on your cocktail list.
All right, guys, this is Brittany.
Hi,
everybody.
Hi.
How are you? I know some of your faces, which is exciting. So we're going to talk a little bit about each of the marks. One of them you do not actually have here. Hopefully you will in the future. Hi, Henry. But I work directly for Constellation, so this is one of the many brands that I represent here. So thank you for all that you do for us. High West is a really interesting whiskey, especially in comparing to what you may have already tasted or what you carry here. So Brendan Coyle is our master blender. We call him a master blender and not a master distiller because there is a small percentage of what we actually distill in our Utah distillery, but we are badasses at distilling and blending just as a whole. So the first thing you have in your glass is the double rye. So the first question we usually get asked is why double rye? So this is made up of two different ryes. The youngest of the ryes that's blended in here is a minimum of 2 years old. With a lot of the whiskeys, or all of the whiskeys actually, we're really going for more of a profile and a taste rather than, and consistency really is going to be key with a lot of the High West whiskeys. So it's never less than 2 years old as far as the youngest in the double rye, all the way up to 12 years old.
So if you haven't already, please take a sip as I'm kind of talking through all of these, and we won't take too much time on each of them. But the double rye is what we call the spiciest rye in the world. So Dave and Jane Perkins started, and I know that they shared a bit about the history, but Dave and Jane actually produced the double rye second to Rendezvous Rye, which we will taste shortly as well. And the double rye really is supposed to be representative of the grape rye whiskeys of the world. And Dave particularly came to fall in love with rye whiskey after studying under the master distiller of Four Roses and his experiments there. And being a biochemist, he really enjoys blending for a chemical compound, if you will. So what do y'all think?
Delicious.
So considering it's a rye, it has a spice. I mean, you're talking two ryes. So there's no corn blended in there at all, or no corn distilled and blended in there. So when I think we're doing American Prairie next, so you will see a huge difference. You probably should have tasted that first, but that's okay. It'll give you a nice differentiation. So I'll give you all a chance to get that in front of you.
The spice on the tip of the tongue creeps up on you after
it does. It's like the tip of your tongue and then the back of your mouth.
Yes.
So it's really complex.
You
could
feel like going down.
Yeah, that's one of my favorites.
What would be like a good snack? Or
good snack?
Watching your face.
Like, you know,
Doritos.
As far as complimentary, I would almost do like something that has a spice to it. It's like wasabi, like trailer or something like that. I've not personally tried it, but like, but that might be interesting.
Was it like
probably
spicy?
Spice.
Spicy.
That would be my suggestion.
Everybody got it?
It'll be a good experiment for us all to do next time too, maybe like a few pairing. So the next whiskey you have is the American Prairie Bourbon. So this is bourbon. Obviously, it's going to be predominantly corn. Again, we do source. I can tell you some of the secrets, but not all the secrets. We source predominantly from Indiana, and we do have a 1,600-gallon pot still in our distillery in Utah. So like I said, there is some proprietary that we're distilling and blending back in there. But you're getting just a really smooth bourbon here. The American Prairie bottle itself, every bottle that is sold, 10% of the after-tax proceeds goes to preserving the West. So the American Prairie organization, I think it's called, and don't quote me on that, but we actually invest that for every single bottle that is sold to preserve the West. So that organization has existed for a long time. American Prairie Reserve in Northwest Montana. Thank you.
So working to preserve 5,000 square miles, that area is larger than Yellowstone, Yosemite, and the Grand Tetons combined.
Come on.
Nice.
He was there.
Oh, you
over there.
Is anyone from like that area by chance?
She's not here today.
Yeah, Nicole. Nicole's out there.
Nicole's out west.
Oh, geez.
She's in Wyoming. Wyoming. She'll be back very soon.
Yeah,
she'll be back soon.
She's sending us
awesome
pictures.
What does everybody think? Yeah, I'm sure. Yes.
So, with each bottle sold, there is money that's being sent to the American Prairie Reserve. That's
yes, 10% of every after-tax purchase.
Yeah.
Yes.
That first one.
So that's always a fun, if you have a lot of, I know you guys have a lot of regular clientele here, so if you have people that are philanthropic or any charity events you might have, Hi-West is always a great kind of 1-2 punch of a brand because they do invest a lot back into the community. Dan and Jane are still very, or excuse me, Dave and Jane are still very much involved in the community there, and this is one way that they kind of give back.
And what I like so much about Hi-West, and I've been doing a lot of reading about distilled by and produced by, I think we talked about it briefly on the first day, is that you guys have always been completely transparent in the fact that they are buying a good amount of their products from the Midwest grain, MGP products are going into. Where companies get into trouble with this is that they don't disclose that, and then people get upset. They feel like they've been deceived by different companies. You guys have always been forthright
from the beginning.
Absolutely.
Yes.
We're great at blending.
Yes.
And to go from a blended product that goes in a whole lot of places and in a lot of different bottles to award winning, that's commendable.
Yes. Thank you. So that's one thing too, and you probably touched on this already, since you guys are probably pretty well versed about the brand itself, but in a short time frame of 10 years, we opened the distillery and then became distillery of the year. So that's huge, as far as we're talking about the quality of the liquid in the bottle, and really him being a chemist, a biochemist, he's all about blending and compounds, like I said. So when you think about that, it's not too surprising, but it is pretty impressive in the grand scheme of all of the whiskeys in the world. Next, we're going to talk about Rendezvous Rye, which I think you may have. I'm not sure.
Yeah,
they have Rendezvous already?
Yes, so Rendezvous, the second thing that I handed all of you, when you all kept asking me what it is Rendezvous. This one is not on our list. I love your product. I've always loved your product. I begged for a couple things, and I like this one. This was in my collection until Tara drank my entire effing bottle. She's leaving, so I can say this now. I have a lot of good High West stories and some blurry photos from all of them. That night that I told you about in Vermont, that was all High West. But this one I love. She's going to talk about Campfire that we already have after this, and then the last one was the one that I really begged for, and Luke came through for it. Yippee-ki-yay, mother. That's one's coming
mother.
Later. It's implied from there, right? So anyway, this one, again, not on our list yet, but please enjoy.
Right? He asked for it, too, right?
Yeah. He writes checks, I cash checks.
This is extremely different. You'll know when you have this in front of your, So Rendezvous Rye is actually our flagship whiskey. So, like I said, Double Rye, kind of was the brainchild second to Rendezvous Rye. So this was really produced in kind of a nod to the West End. Back in the 1800s, there used to be a rendezvous, essentially a festival at the time, not festivals like we have now, but where people in the West would meet and they would trade goods. So they called it Rendezvous, I think it was Rendezvous Festival or something along those lines. So this was kind of a dedication and a nod to us being in Utah and the home of the West. So again, a combination of different ryes. There is some corn in here as well, but not as spicy as the Double Rye, but really, really mixable, but also great paired with ice.
Paired with ice. Or air.
This is gonna have, in my opinion, and you guys give me some feedback if you'd like, a little bit more herbaceous notes versus what the Double Rye did. The Double Rye, you get a lot of spice, a lot of cinnamon, a lot of star anise. This is a little bit rounder. It doesn't quite get you in the back of the throat like the Double Rye does. Is anyone a rye drinker here personally? What do you think?
Delicious.
So you don't currently have this now, but if it's something you would like to have, rally. Please, with these folks. and the last we're going to do Campfire. So Campfire, once you have it, it is extremely self-explanatory as to why you call it Campfire. This is a very, very interesting whiskey. I would probably bet everything in my bank account that this is the only one of its kind in the world. So it is definitely something that you can share with guests who want to try something different.
Get in the
camp.
Or... you want to go camping?
If it's not the only one, it's at least the first one.
Yes, exactly. So definitely first, and possibly I think the only one of its kind that's actually open for distribution. Let's say that. That's widely distributed. So
I'm pretty sure this is a completely unique product.
Proprietary.
Doing anything like this.
I've heard a few different companies try to kind of imitate this and not really nail it. But again, so we're taking three different types of whiskey, bourbon, or scotch, and we're essentially making something extremely unique. So you have a combination here of scotch whiskey from Scotland. This is actually, let me back up a little bit. So this was actually produced by Dave and Jane as an inspiration from their trip when they were in Scotland. So the story goes that they had a dish for breakfast that came with a peated syrup that was topped on like waffles or pancakes, something like that, which is pretty unique in and of itself. And they said, well, why can't we do this with whiskey? Why can't we bring this back and blend it with some of our amazing bourbons and whiskeys that we have? So that's what they did. So this is typically, the percentages are not disclosed, but it's essentially a third, a third, a third. And we try to keep that consistent across all of the bottlings that we do over the years. So you have bourbon, you have rye, and you have Scotch whiskey from Scotland. You're obviously going to get that peat right on the nose, but you're not going to get it immediately when you sip it. So you're going to get it more on the nose and then in the back of the throat, like you did kind of with the rye. Very interesting. It should be enjoyed on the rocks. Let's just say that. It's not really something you want to use as a cocktail base. It's really, really complex and bold, so it really is meant to stand alone.
Who would be someone that you could sell this to?
After dinner drink, aperitif.
Glenn Ryan.
Somebody who's already drinking
yeah.
a peated scotch.
Yeah. Lafroy, anything like that. If you have a Lafroy drinker and you want them to try something super unique, this is a great option, especially because you're only getting peated scotch from Scotland. So it's definitely a unique story and unique mark. Does anyone love it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
Great.
I love that.
Very cool. I think that's all we have. Oh, we have
one
more.
What am I talking about?
Okay.
She and I were fighting like nationally together however many years ago. You got one at the airport.
I got it at the Park City Saloon.
You got it at the saloon?
I got it at the saloon.
Did
so,
you?
Yeah, years ago I was in Utah. I did 7 national parks in 14 days. Anybody up for a challenge? I'm always up for a good road trip with national parks. Involved. But ended in Park City and ended at the High West Distillery. This was 2007.
Okay, so it's new.
The bottle I still have is batch number 5.
Ooh.
What's the batch number on that?
19,
I think.
What?
Batch 19, it says 1922, so I'm gonna assume that means 2019's batch 22. I bought this when it was only sold at the distillery, which is kind of how I go with things. I want things I can't buy at home, so I'm so excited and jazzed. This is on the list now.
Lake Park
this is on the list. This is this is Yubi Kaya.
What would be a good price for that?
I've got all the prices.
Have you looked at our price sheet?
I give them to you.
Yes. What do you know? What you're selling it for now?
I have all of them on a list here.
Okay.
In a minute.
Just so you all know, it's not so much for me, but just so you guys know, if you want to upsell something from the High West portfolio, something extremely unique. The four we went through is what we call our core four. The Yippee Kaye, as well
anybody?
As a few other marks, are limited editions. The Yippee Kaye starts as a rye. I believe it's our double rye that we start with. It's a distillate. And we age this in...
Midnight
Summer Stray. I'm like, I got
did you bring that?
No.
Just gonna get bugged in the parking lot. What else in the car? Remember, like when he talked about finished bourbons, like when it goes into a second barrel, and when he talked previously that there's like 3 or 4 gallons of liquid in the barrel.
Mm-hmm.
So when it's going in and out, it's extrapolating some of that.
Mm-hmm.
This is gonna hit 2 of them. So it's sweet vermouth and use. Syrah. For my wine guy. They get the Syrah from Coupe.
Really?
Kind of. Anybody know a prestige wine that we got a tequila aged in here?
Prestige what wine?
Yeah.
Wait, what was your question?
There's a prestige wine that we have a finished tequila in. How about you guys know your bar? What?
Codigo Rosé.
Correct. What is it in?
It's in a.
I'll give you a hint. It's on our list for $3,250.
It's a good upsell.
The Codigo Rosé is aged in Harlan barrels.
If you can't sell throwing that out there, the same thing that if you can't hit with a coupe, that you're actually getting the wine to overlap into this on a prestige brand anyway, you can throw out the vermouth if you want, but the coupe was always how I pushed this.
Wait, what's coupe? What is that?
It's not on our list, but it is a very solid, consistent name recognition Syrah. I don't remember how they work.
Edible Channing or Barossa? Syrah.
Syrah.
Then it's Syrah.
True, but It's kind of like, well, then why is Maker's Mark not having E in whiskey? They can still
because they
blend going back to Iran in 1471 when you extrapolate that, then put down into the two penal colonies, which is why South Africa and Australia are going to pull it a certain way. Whereas Syrah would be in the Rhone Valley because it had a different name, and then they just decided to take the same grape, the same genus, put it in two different styles. This is just for you.
Yeah, it's more stylistic, not so much, it's not like a legal, you know, we're not talking like Italian wine where you have to legally call it something.
But I will make it something all for us.
Later.
But, so this is in a sweet vermouth?
Sweet vermouth and a Syrah barrels.
Wow.
So finished, essentially. So blend, it's our blended whiskey,
yeah.
And then we finish it that way.
Like,
yeah, you're going to get like some dry cherries, toffee, again, really, really complex. This is a limited edition. We typically release this one kind of season of the year. And then we also have two others that we release, Boo Rye, it's called. So it's a combination of bourbon and rye. And then Midwinter Strength.
And that is Christmas in a bottle. And I've heard from many different people that that's what they get at Christmas, and they kill the bottle on the day because it's bottled Christmas. Midwinter Night's Dram. It runs you about $100 in the store.
Wow. What is it called?
Midwinter's Night Dram.
I like that.
Don't they do a summer? A midsummer night dram?
No.
Okay.
Maybe from the distillery, but I don't.
Maybe.
I don't know. They've been there. I don't know.
It's been years.
What do you think of the Apicae? Do you guys have clientele in mind that you can sell something unique like this to?
Yeah.
Yeah, wine people.
Wine people.
There you go.
This would be for women.
Yeah. It's softer. It's round. It's clean. It doesn't have like that spice. Yeah.
Familiar with.
Again, best served on the rocks or neat.
And Murphy salad.
Do you guys have any questions for me that hopefully I can answer?
What's your favorite portfolio?
My favorite is Double Rye. That's my go-to. I mean, if we're talking like Yippee-ki-yay, I love, but it's not something I would drink every day. Not feel guilty, so Double Rye is. I drink a lot of Double Rye on Friday, so yeah, that's fine. So, do you guys have a favorite, just your personal
Campfire.
Like?
Campfire.
I'm like so impressed and excited about this. That's awesome.
It's not my fault.
It's unique. I mean, and I would imagine you guys have quite a bit of Scotch drinkers here too. So it's a great talking point to say that we have something that isn't found everywhere. I mean, it is more commonly found than the limited editions, but not too many places are successful with it because they don't have the clientele that you guys have. So I think you could do great with it.
Guys, we're okay with anybody doing, hey, if it's something that you're interested in, you talk them up to it, take them a taste.
We don't have Rendezvous.
We don't have Rendezvous, but we have the rest. We have the other ones
like
that we tasted from High West State. Take them a taste. The worst that's going to happen is they're going to say no.
Yeah, even like I was saying, like people really get into the smoked kind of thing, or like smoked old fashioned, like that would be a great substitution for it. Like, hey, we do have this like smoked drink.
Because you don't have a smoker downstairs, correct?
We're only doing smoke drinks.
So that is a great idea. If we ask for a smoker to get that downstairs, you can say we don't have the smoker, but I do have a smoky rye. Would you like to try it with the smoky rye?
Somebody wanted a smoky ice. I put three things on a flight. I put a Lagavulin, because to me that's the standard. I hid that in the middle. I put Campfire. Deep dive on your liquor. What other smoky?
Vodka.
No.
I thought you could the Belvedere.
Oh, we don't
rye.
Have good mezcal.
The Belvedere.
That's exactly why. What else did I put on there to throw him a curveball? Come on, something you count it in inventory and you never reach for it.
Wait.
See, this is why I kill you guys on inventory. I put Westland Peated because they're like, "This is a really good scotch." I'm like, "Great, I got it from Seattle." Nobody sees that coming. That opens the door. So Westland Peated. Westland out of Washington State, so they've got a peated one. So now they're used to having their scotch, and then we throw them Utah and Washington. Now you've got alpha dog them. Guide them where you go from there. Open them up to something new instead of just getting their same drink they've had for 42 years.
Thanks for your time, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We're all like, we're
five.
I gotta
be
the campfire.
All right, guys, I'm gonna jump in. I'm gonna give you a weekly challenge first, and I'm going to modify this challenge a little bit than what's on the screen because we have Woodford here today and High West here today. So for the week, we're going to do a High West challenge. And until Dred let you know prices. We do Double Rye for 15, Boo Rye for 22, the American Prairie at 15, Campfire sells at 22, and the Yippee-ki-yays at 35. To that, we're going to skip Widow Jane this week because she couldn't be here and talk about her products. And then Woodford Reserve is on our list at $24. All of these items this week for the contest are going to be double points.
Oh, yeah.
So, we've given you lots of information on all of these brands today. So, earn some double points and earn your space and earn some really great space on the contest. To
so
do that, you want to start with
Widow
bartending?
Widow Jane going to still be a part of it, even though with
more I'm not going to do Widow Jane as a part of the contest this week. If we can get her in at another point, she couldn't make it today. So when and I'm close on time, I try to guys have you out of here by like 2 o'clock, so I don't want to go into it.
Oh,
yeah,
yeah,
no, cocktails don't count, though.
Cocktails with this liquor count. You just have to ring them as the cocktail.
Okay.
So a Boulevardier would count for this. No. That's a High West as the base, so that would be a double point cocktail also. from here, do we want to start with bartenders or servers?
Bartenders.
Because they're because we've got bartenders first. So Jason,
oh,
works like 3 days a week. It doesn't really matter. It's all in how you do it. You say he works upstairs, he works 3 days a week. 13, 12.
Josh!
1386. Josh doesn't really work upstairs. And who's up at the top?
Todd.
Todd?
No, Bree.
I took some time off.
I think it's
Bree. High 500!
Woo! There you go.
And to pull from the very beginning, Rachel's got her bases down. She's got the knowledge.
Yeah.
She's doing extra studying. I can see that already. So there goes the knowledge right back into those sales.
Thanks.
On the server side. Shelby? Who do we think is in top two?
Jess
hasn't been here. Jess is like in 12.
That's true.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it was Daniela,
Sam.
Sam had an appointment.
Okay. I think Sam.
Daniela.
Tim.
Vinny.
Is Vinny on the
phone? No, I'm not there. I've been trying. I'm not there, though.
To clarify, what do our servers have to do to be eligible for prizes?
Four classes. They haven't made to one of them, so.
Yeah, we have three classes left.
And there are three classes left.
So,
I'm checking yourself. 4, 5, 6.
I have it in a spreadsheet, I'll tell you later, but I'm really only pulling top three for here. We talked about this one. September is Bourbon Heritage Month. This was something that was passed by Congress in 2007. This was a Kentucky senator, and it was passed unanimously. This was designed to celebrate the love of bourbon with responsibility and respect, and it also solidified creation culture and the craft of the bourbon industry. Going into September, we are a bourbon-based bar. We are running a bourbon-style contest for everybody. I've got more prizes from High West and from Woodford today that we're adding to the prize baskets. I have stuff from Cooper's Craft, from Brown-Forman. I have stuff from Evan Williams. I have stuff from a whole bunch of different places from Maker's Mark along the way that I'm adding that we picked up in Kentucky for the prize bag. So prize bag is going to be pretty nice. Rachel's the one to beat on the bar.
Yeah.
Good luck, guys.
No more tequila away tomorrow.
I can't.
She's been spreading love to people showing up. That's up to what they bring. That's not up to me. I've got extras. I've got some extra things that we can pass out, but that'll be to who wins. This is a winner take all contest.
Okay.
Guys, do we have questions for me? Do we have questions for Scott?
Thanks, Scott.
Thank you.
Hi, Alicia.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your time.
Yeah.
Guys, thanks for coming. If you had something to drink, drink some water.
You got it.